they had to do was go step up to God, remember his covenant. He's just an awesome God. So here in verse 5, David is still talking about God. Let's look at verse 6. And verse 6 says, he has shown his people the power of his voice, that he may give them the heritage of the heathen. And he had a nation that the Israelites were going to come before, that they were going to come in contact with. Regardless of how massive they were or how few God's people were, God's people always won. And he kept on giving them the power over the heathen. I use this illustration about a video recall. If you had a football team that was your favorite team, and they had maybe a playoff game or a good game that you were really interested in, but you couldn't see it, so you video recall that game. But somebody spoiled it. They told you your team won, but they only won by 1 or 2 points. It didn't matter whether it was 3 points or 20 points. Your main thing was your team won. And so knowing that your team won, when you sat down and watched that video recording, it didn't matter how far they were behind. It didn't matter how many times the quarterback had sacked. It didn't matter how many times you threw interception. You knew that at the end, your team was going to win. Because somebody already told you that your team was going to win. It's the same thing with God. As long as we stick with God, we'll always win in the end. It doesn't matter what we're going through. Staying with God will always win in the end. And then we go on in verse 7. It says, the works of his hand are buried in confession. All his commandments are still. The works of God's hand are true confession. Nothing that God does is underhanded. God demands justice. And because sometimes we fail to acknowledge the fact that God is a God of justice, we focus so much on his mercy and his grace. And his love that we forget and we forget that he's a God of justice. We stay bound because God is such a gracious God. He allows us an opportunity to repent of our transgressions. But unless we repent, we're going to pay for it. We're going to pay for it. And so let's never forget that he's a God of justice as well. And all the imperfections that we have, God has given us a means of making it perfect, and that is through his Son, Jesus Christ. But the main thing here, in verse 7, David is talking about God. The works of his hand, the verity and judgment, all his commandments are still. Speaking of God and God's name. In verse 8, the Bible says, they stand fast forever and ever, and are God in truth and uprightness. Everything that God has done stands fast forever and ever. We don't have to go back and tweak anything, or retweak anything, or repair anything, or replace anything that God has put in motion. Everything that God has put in motion has been there. God put the stars in the sky, birds have never gone out. Nobody ever had to go and replace certain birds because, ooh, that star has gone out. I need to replace the bird. Never. Not with God. When he tilted this earth and put it on his axis and put it in his rotation, nobody could go and greedy the axis to make sure that the ball bearings are aligned or they haven't curled it up. No, because God put that in. And so, in the first 8 verses, David is speaking about God and God alone. And look at verse 9. He sent redemption continues to. And we know the help of that day when he says he sent redemption to his people, because that's Jesus is our redeemer. He is our redemption. He is our means of being perfect in the eyesight of God. If I had time, I'd show you in the New Testament where we are called to Christ. Those of us who have been baptized into the body of Christ have put Christ on. And by wearing Christ as our clothes, that helps us to be, in fact, that doesn't just help us, but that makes us to be perfect in the eyesight of God. In other words, in order for God to see me, he has to look through his Son Jesus in order to see me. If I have been baptized into Christ, if I have been clothed into Christ, then when God looks for me, he looks through his Son Jesus in order to see me. Outside of Jesus, I'm not fit for God to look at. I've got sin in my life. I've got transgressions in my life. I've got things that I'm not even proud of. Very disappointed in. And some of the things that I have done in my life. But I've got redeemed through the blood of Christ. I've been saved by being baptized into his body. And when God looks for me, he looks through Jesus in order to see me. So there is no doubt in verse 9 that David, when he says he sent redemption unto his people, he has commanded his covenant forever. In other words, when God gives a command, he doesn't go back and say, well, you know, I made a mistake, let me change that. I need to revise this. God doesn't revise his word. His word stands forever. He has commanded his covenant forever. And then God says, holy and reverend is his name. Reverend is God's name. There is not a man on earth who qualifies to wear a name that references God. None of us qualify for that name. In order to call a man reverend, we're either bringing God down to the level of man or trying to elevate man up to the level of God. I know people want to be a honor, but that's not some honor that you have earned. No man has earned that honor. So this morning, I just want to share with you God's command about certain honor. Look at verse 10. The psalmist says here in verse 10, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. When we start recognizing who God is and start giving reverence to God as God and not trying to put man in the seat of God, that is the beginning of wisdom. We become wise when we learn how to feel God and how to love God. He goes on to say, a good understanding that all they that do this commandment. When we recognize that what I need to do is do what God would have me to do, and that's when I start understanding and gaining wisdom. His praise endures forever. And here again, I just think we need to praise God more and more. But the question comes up, if I'm not supposed to call my preacher or reverend, what do I call my preacher? Well, if I ask that question, I'm going to ask the question, and it too comes from the Bible. In Matthew, the chapter is 23, Matthew chapter 23, I don't know. Read verses 8 and 9. Now, as a prerequisite to that, in the commentary chapter of Matthew, Jesus is talking to the multitude of his disciples, and he's talking about how hypocritical the Pharisees are. He talks about how they want to sit in the most honored seats, and how they stand the tassels on the ropes and make them look more say really hard. We talked about how rather than just having a scripture of David, it could be a bit for that to see it move down and ask if they know so much about God's word. But he said that you need to do what they tell you to do, but don't follow their example. But when it comes to our addressing one to another, verse 8 says, but be not you called the rabbi, for one is your master, even Christ, and all ye are brethren. Now, Jesus is talking about giving religious commands to one another. I'm the minister here to the Westminster Church of Christ. I'm not a reverend, I'm a God of reverend. I'm not their father of the church. Another brother. I have a different responsibility than the son of me. And a brother who comes up and works the scriptures over the communion. The brothers who do other things. But all of us are brothers. The term brethren represents men and women. So the females are sisters, and the males are brothers. We don't have any specific titles. We are all brothers. And if we live right, then we will get the proper honor. This man says, he called no man your father upon the earth. And here again, we're talking about religious terms. We're not talking about your physical father, then you have to respect him. If you call him father, he calls my father dad. My kids call me dad or daddy. It's nothing about that, but he's talking about respect in terms of a religious title. Call him your father, for one is your father, which is in heaven. I bought this lesson. This is a short lesson to me. But I believe as a minister, that our lessons need to be educational. I think that you need to learn something from the lessons that you hear. Oftentimes we go to church and we go to where the church assembles in. And many people say, well, you know, I didn't get anything out of it. Well, you know, what did you put in? What did you put in? When we come together, to praise God and to offer a sacrifice to God. And every time that we come to worship God, it ought to be a time that we are lifting God up and praising Him, and that we are offering a sacrifice to God. That's what worship is all about. It's not coming out to be entertained, but it's coming out to offer a sacrifice and to praise God. And we just pray that once this pandemic is over, the restrictions are lifted to where we can come back and to worship together and to communication, that these things are taking place. And those of you who are listening from us this morning, who are not part of this conversation, we welcome you at any time that you have an area, if you will, to come out and worship with us, to spirit and to truth. Again, I thank you for listening to us this morning. At this time, the brothers will come forward and take you through another passage of worship. Remember, 2 weeks ago we talked about communion and contribution. Whenever there's a contribution, there ought to be a communion. God bless you and God keep you. At this time, Brother Cedric Reagan is going to come forward and he will guide us to separate the passage from worship. Thank you.
Morning. At this time, we would like to draw your attention to the offering. If we look at 2 Corinthians, the chapter is 9, the verses are 6 and 7, and it reads, but this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly, and he which soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully. Every man, according as he prospers in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly nor of necessity. For God loveth a cheerful giver. At this time, I'd like to draw your attention on how you may deliver your offering. It could be sent to Huff Smith Church of Christ, P.O. Box 18, Huff Smith, Texas, 77377-0018. You may send your offering in through the mail, or perhaps you can contact Brother Robinson or Brother Jimmy Johnson. Also, let us at this time direct your attention to communion. And we follow our instructions in the Bible. We look at Corinthians, the 1 Corinthians, the chapter is 11. The verses start at 23. For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus Christ, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat, this is my body, for which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. After the same manner, he took the cup, and when he had supped, saying, This is the cup, the New Testament in my blood. Do